First of all, let me thank you for the invitation and all the organizers for setting up this interesting meeting. You set the bar quite high. I have to point out several disclaimers, I think, at the beginning. Yeah. First of all, it's not so much me in this talk who will provide this grand vision of explaining natural intelligence. I let more the data speak. Yeah, and point out several phenomena which I think are interesting and maybe relevant for intelligence. Although here I immediately have to make another disclaimer. We talk about, or I say intelligence, but then actually to make it concrete and to say something about a part of the brain that is well investigated, it's more that we talk about perception. And actually we talk about perception of simple stimuli. What we know about the visual cortex, and this is what you actually see, is part of the visual cortex. We think that if we gain a good understanding of the visual cortex, we can actually transfer some of that to other parts of the brain which are involved in higher cognitive function and so on. Yeah? Because anatomically wise and also in terms of functional activity, there's actually quite some analogies or common aspects between different cortical areas. So this in fact is part of the visual cortex. It's not a human visual cortex, it's a cortex from ferrets, Frettchen in German. And what you see here are activity patterns. So the white domains are actually domains that are active. So this whole thing is approximately 4 millimeters in diameter. It's actually a window that replaces part of the skull, the bone. And it allows you to, and then the neural tissue is genetically manipulated such that active cells become fluorescent. So you can see, literally see and watch the activity. This is real time. And you see that the activity goes on in complex activity patterns, right? And this would look very similar if we were able now to look into your visual cortex, which is at the back of your head, and open it and look up the activity patterns. They will look really similar when you look at me while I'm talking and explaining you these things. Okay, that's why ferrets is actually a good model system. It's also a good model system for other reasons. I come to that. Let me say something about my background. So my background, so my field of research is computational neuroscience, which you could think of being nested somewhere between natural and artificial intelligence. Actually, it's more about like a theoretical computational approach to understanding brain function. Yeah, and so mostly the AI part comes in my case, when I want to understand phenomena like these, right? These are complex activity patterns, and I know that they mean something, they encode something, and they have some peculiar structure, and it's of course an interesting but also quite challenging task to understand these activity patterns better, right? And for this, image analysis, like dimension reduction and different methods from machine learning can definitely help. And this is probably the larger fraction of my encounters with artificial intelligence. But then also there is this other direction, right? The opposite direction, because this is not some biological system, but this is actually a system that itself processes, represents information. And so there is maybe the hope also that we can learn from this system how we can build better next generation AI. So neuro-inspired AI is the opposite direction. And this is mostly the direction that I would like to focus on today. And as I said, I do it data-driven. I show you a few peculiar phenomena, which I think could be relevant. And as a disclaimer again, it's getting a bit biological, neurobiological, so bear with me here and there, but I hope I get across some of the concepts. So I start out, however, with a deep neural network, and a similar network was shown today already, and I want to make basically one point here, which is that in these networks, for instance, this one, which is trained to do something like face or object recognition, you find in low-level layers, right? You find interesting features in the sense that, so these are features, for instance, that represent edges of object. And these kind of features are interesting because there's also a very well-defined like stage in processing in the mammalian brain, where also you see these kind of features being represented and processed. And this is actually one of the most well-studied parts of the brain, of the cortex in particular, the primary visual cortex. And that's basically the one of the systems I want to focus in here today, because it's well studied and you can actually understand what's going on, because it's relatively close, still near to the sensory periphery, right? You can present a stimulus and look at the response, and since it's a similar, it's a relatively simple feature, you also get some relatively good understanding of what's going on. So object like representations and processing themselves, I mean, they're interesting, of course, they're also happening in the brain, but they are more challenging to understand in the brain. So we want to stay at this rather simple layer here, okay? And that like edges or a stimulus like a grating is a very like important one for humans. You can actually see when you go to Frankfurt and visit the Museum Städel, you see this image. And actually when you, this painting, or a piece of art, and when you actually stand in front of that, I mean in real, and you would have the similar feeling if you were standing here now, you would, it would really literally hurt the eyes. Yeah? When you look at this, it's such a strong stimulus, it is almost painful, and when you talk to a neurobiologist, like doing experiments in Frettchen, they have the experience that a stimulus like this is a stimulus that evokes, that drives basically neurons the best from all the stimulus. So more than natural scenes, so these gratings, and in particular when you move these gratings, yeah, really drive cells very strongly in the visual cortex. And yeah, this is part of the, this is related to the fact that edge representation, edge processing is very important in the, in the, in the primary visual cortex. So where is that? So that's the image. Information is sent via the thalamus to the primary visual cortex, which is, as I said, at the back of your head. And this is the system you want to focus on, right? And then when you look, for instance, in an animal like ferrets, where you can actually really record neural activity, you will observe something like this, that when you present in individual neurons, they have their receptive fields, so a particular part of the visual field where they are looking at. This neurons, where they get basically input from. And when you present a stimulus that is not matching the preferred orientation of that stimulus, then you don't see much activity. If it matches the preferred orientation, then you see lots of activity. You can do this for many cells. So this is now a larger part of the visual cortex. Here's the scale bar. You can present a stimulus like a moving grating, as I showed you. And here you will see the cells that are active given this particular stimulus. You can see when you change basically the angle of that orientation, different domains, different groups of cells become active, okay? So, yeah? So when you drive basically with a given angle, a certain domains of cells become active. If you use different angle, nearby domains and so on. And you can all color code this, you can all visualize this quite nicely in this so-called orientation map, which is shown here, where basically you color code the visual angle which is driving these particular neurons that sit here best, okay? And that's a beautiful, peculiar structure, because underlying you have really individual neurons, right? But you have sort of this mesoscopic pattern in your brain, also in your brains, which defines the layout, the spatial layout in your cortical tissue of how visual angles are encoded. Yeah? And you have to think of this a little bit like this, so that this would be the visual field, right? These would be different edges in the visual field, and different edges are also different positions are mapped in different locations. But then on top, this this feature here, orientation, is also mapped and is represented here by the color. Yeah, so both visual location and the orientation are mapped. Now, this is all like textbook neuroscience. Now I throw you into something that is more at the current frontier of neuroscience. And here I come to my first like encounter with restlessness. Yeah? So because when you present now a stimulus like this and you do it here, then you see this is the activity pattern. But now you don't present any stimulus. There's just a gray screen. Yeah? Now you present a stimulus again. You see there is an activity pattern encoding this. Now
There's no, and now please look at the moments where there's no stimulus being presented. You see that there's still activity going on. There's ongoing activity which is rich, which is spatially extended, which is dynamic right there, for instance. You see all these active domains. This is why no stimulus is represented really, right? So not only, yeah, the visual cortex is not only active when you show a stimulus, it's not just a stimulus response machine, but it's actually active also in between, and you can zoom in and look at the cellular levels. So here you have basically a zoomed inversion, you have really individual neurons here. You can still sort of glance or identify these domains of coactive cells, but you see also these neurons. And this is actually in a case where the animal sits in the darkness, so no visual input whatsoever. Nevertheless, the visual system is constantly producing activity patterns, okay? Yeah. This is the first example of a restlessness that I'm encountering here in this talk. There will be three in total. And actually, I don't want to stay and devote too much time on this example of restlessness. Yeah? What I have to say about this is mostly speculative. We don't understand what it means. Of course, it could mean something like some visual memory, or maybe it could encode some prior, yeah, that the visual system has, yeah, some expectation of what inputs to come and what activity patterns to use to represent and so on. And there's all kinds of interesting questions one could ask about this, and maybe also experiments, like how does the spontaneous activity change when you present certain stimuli and so on. And this is all nice and interesting. I should also say it's a bit difficult, yeah? So it's not by far not understood. And it's by far not understood what the spontaneous activity means. It's very structured, and it's sometimes remarkably similar to activity patterns that are evoked by visual stimulation, but it's not easy to actually link the two. I want to move slightly in a different direction. I want to move into the direction of development. Still visual system and still these moving gratings as a stimuli and so on, but focusing on basically a different scientific question. That's the scientific question of how the system is set up. How does it learn to see, basically, okay? And this is sort of visualizes the improvement in us, in humans, from being newborn to 4 months later, right? There's an immense, and this is, of course, schematic. It's a sort of a guess, yeah? But to all that we know, there's a tremendous increase in our visual capabilities, in particular, the visual acuity, yeah? And one long-standing question in neuroscience, but actually also in philosophy, is the question of nature versus nurture. So nurture means basically the environment, the sensory experience that is important for allowing the system to go from here to here. Yeah? And of course, that's important. But there's also another side, yeah, which is the side of nature. And this includes genes and epigenetics, which are, as we all know, also important in building brains, right? And there's this long-standing question in neuroscience, basically, which of the two plays what role? Delivered by nature, by itself? When does nurture kick in? So what I think is really interesting is the interaction between the two, because of course they interact, yeah, and they interact on network levels, yeah. So the main question here, I think, would be how does experience interact with these endogenous factors, right, which are set up here to form robust sensory representations, okay? And you can think, instead of robust sensory representations, you can also think of conceptual representations at some point, right? How much of that is learnable, and how much of that relies on preset structures, on precursors that are set up by genes? And with genes, I don't mean necessarily that these genes really define entirely the network directly, but these genes could set, for instance, parameters of some self-organizing dynamics, yeah, between circuitry and activity patterns, some rules, basically, which build these networks, but without experience, or without much experience at least, right? This could be the role of nature. And then at some point, experience kicks in, and the question is, what is there at the time where experience kicks in, and what comes later? And this is definitely an interesting question for neuroscience, but I think it's also an interesting question for AI, because current AI is more on the right-hand side, right? It's basically data, 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 okay? And our brains, our intelligence doesn't evolve like that. Yeah, it's not a tabula rasa or like a blank slate which we are born with. We are actually born with quite a lot of structure. But it's actually not easy to understand and to reveal, to measure the amount of structure that is there at the beginning of development, at the time of eye-opening, for instance. Yeah, but this is where we wanted to head at, yeah? In particular, understanding again how these simple feature detectors are developing. And we had the privilege to team up with a really cool experimental group at the Max Planck Florida Institute. Yeah, so this is the director, David Fitzpatrick. He's basically heading this group. And it's, to my knowledge, the only Max Planck Institute in the US. Yeah, there's a peculiar story about this, but let me not get into that. But what these guys have developed experimentally is the ability to record from ferret visual cortex. And ferret visual cortex, during development, is an interesting experimental system because it's born in a relatively immature state. Eye opening is only around P30 in ferrets. So this means that a lot of the development that in us, yeah, we open the eyes basically right after birth. A lot of the development that in humans and in primates in general happens prior to birth, actually in ferrets, happens after birth. And so it's much more easy to monitor, right? So they developed microscopy techniques, wild field epifluorescence imaging combined with genetic markers that allow them to label active cells. And then basically what you can do in the system, you can infect these cells and you can do longitudinal imaging of individual ferrets. You basically prepare the ferrets that starting at P20 or slightly later, but several days prior to eye opening, you can start imaging spontaneous activity and also to some extent evoke activity, and you can monitor this animal while it's developing its, while spontaneous activity is developing and also the evoked activity, okay? And this has been a very interesting collaboration, and next slide I show you how this early activity looks like. And to our surprise, like 5 years ago or so when we did this, it was surprising to us how structured this spontaneous activity is already prior to eye opening, right? This is before the time that these animals have opened the eyes, prior to any structured visual input, and still you have remarkably structured activity patterns. But you can see these active domains here. You can see sometimes they are more isolated. Sometimes they fill basically large parts of the cortex. And so the question that we asked, to what extent are these activity patterns precursors or similar of the activity patterns that later on encode visual stimuli, right? And so to do that, we first had to analyze these patterns a little bit better. So what we did here is really simple. We did correlation across time. So basically having many of these patterns of spontaneous activity, and then we can compute the correlation from one seed point to all the others. And we have locations which can be far away, which are highly correlated with this point, and correlations which are the blue domains, which are actually not so much correlated. So we have these correlation patterns, and they are, as I said, they are structured and they're extended in space. This is sort of interesting because when you think of what the visual cortex should achieve eventually, is not only detect local edges, but it should actually be able to process entire scenes, right? Entire scenes, you have long-range correlations, you need to do something like contour binding or so. And so these long-range correlations, they are actually set up here early on. And more remarkably, they are set up without any long-range anatomical connections. So the connectivity here is purely local still. Nevertheless, by an interesting mechanism, some long-range correlations form. And these long-range correlations appear to be precursors of the long-range correlations that are later on used for processing. But this is just as a side note. Let me go to the concrete questions that we were asking. What has this structure to do with the representations of of visual contours that is about to form? And so at the moment of eye opening at P30, we can directly compare the two, right? And this is the comparison, yeah? This is the correlation structure here again. And this is the layout of the edges, how they're encoded in the visual cortex. And now we can draw contour lines here basically defining the different colors, the different domains, encoding the different angles, and superimpose these contour lines on the correlation structure. And as you can see, they match quite nicely, meaning the correlation structure, this is all spontaneous activity, right? Spontaneous activity without any stimulation, match quite nicely in its structure of these activity patterns, the structure of correlation structure, the layout of the encoding of the visual angles. Now, this is interesting already, that there is this correspondence, right, between spontaneous and evoked, but we can go back in time now, because in the same animal, we have also the spontaneous activity already recorded prior to eye opening, sorry. And when you do that, what you see is that even 2 days prior to eye opening, there is some high similarity. I mean, even 4 days prior to eye opening, right, you see that the structure, the correlation structure of spontaneous activity already shows some of the features that it shows at eye opening. Yeah? So again, yeah, all of that develops basically without structured visual input, but as you can see, the representations of visual input that then pop up at eye opening actually take over this structure to some extent, okay? And I say to some extent because this is exactly the question that that is coming up then, right? Is that everything? Is that basically that this that the representation, at least of this fundamental response property, visual angle, yeah, is that basically preset and hardwired and basically encoded in the genes, even if it is via some self-organizing network? But still, is that basically developing without the need of any instruction by visual experience? Potentially, right? And maybe the advantage would be to make it very, very robust, but of course the disadvantage would be to make it not very flexible. Yeah. So it should be one where in the middle, and it's actually surprising if this were the case. And then question would be, is this true also for higher order features? So we were actually trying to get at that recently and asking where's actually the dividing line between what's set up by nature versus what's added by nurture, okay? And so we did this and asked whether basically these networks at eye opening already functional as the mature networks. And the answer, the clear answer was no, but by what criterion? And that is actually interesting, I think, because when you look at like several days after eye opening, when there was experience, you present, these are different trials, you present the same stimulus, a moving grating of a different of a certain orientation, you get a response that is very reproducible. I mean, you plot the contours of these activity patterns, they're very similar, right? When you do this at eye opening or even prior to eye opening, open the lids artificially, like prior to eye opening, then you get also strong responses. Yeah, the brain really does something to the stimulus. It produces an activity pattern that each time looks a bit like the activity pattern that you get in the mature state. But it is different from trial to trial. And you see this variability quite nicely when you superimpose these different contours from the different trial. Yeah? So the system responds strongly. Various possibilities here that it could have been different, right? It could have been that the system is not responding because it doesn't want to make an error or so. This system responds by producing huge errors, right? You could not decode well, basically, from these activity patterns and say what stimulus has been represented. It is very bold in a sense, right? It responds strongly, but it responds in a wrong way. It generates lots of trial-to-trial variability. And another measure we applied was the dimensionality of the responses. Like, so we did a PCA, principal component analysis, and projected all the activity patterns onto the first two principal components. So these principal components, they are also patterns. Project them, you get values, and these are the different responses that we get ordered by the visual angle, okay? And 6 days after eye opening, when the system has matured and learned to represent these stimuli, it's all well ordered and really well described in this two-dimensional subspace of the first two principal components. But at eye opening and prior to that, it's a mess. And it's a mess in the sense not only that you have variability from trial to trial, but actually the responses are more high dimensional than later on. Yeah, here it's close to two-dimensional, here it's actually more like 10-dimensional. And when I say dimensionality, it's linear dimensionality based on the eigenvalues of the covariance matrix, okay? So there is diversity, right? The system produces diversity, strong responses, very diverse, basically as if it were attempting to find basically the right solution. Yeah? Then also, what happens early on is that the system is not similar to the spontaneous patterns. So when you compare basically the evoked patterns to the spontaneous patterns, there is some overlap, but not much overlap. This would be the projection onto the first principal components, the first two of the spontaneous activity, relatively little organization here. 6 days after eye opening, there's a very tight, very close match to the spontaneous activity, meaning these grading evoked responses fall very much into the main space of the spontaneously generated pattern. So if you like the idea of the prior, then you will like that, because this means that now the prior has learned basically to represent, to generate activity patterns that are similar to the evoked activity patterns, right? And you can see this shift here also when you project things onto the variance components of spontaneous activity. Now, another question that we can ask is, okay, there is this convergence between evoked and spontaneous activity. Does that mean spontaneous activity rules and the evoked one goes towards it, meaning that everything goes towards the structure that was pre-wired and set up by the system, by nurture? Or does everything mostly shift to the new patterns, the evoked patterns, right? And of course, it's a mix, and interestingly, actually both change tremendously, but what we find, our empirical data says that it's actually more that the evoked pattern rules. Yeah? So when you compare basically the similarity, yeah, trying to seek the early pattern that is most similar to the mature pattern, then you will find evoked patterns that have a higher degree of similarity than the spontaneous patterns. So there's a gap, yeah? This is control, mature to mature. So there's a gap, but the early evoked is a better predictor of the final outcome. Yeah? So this already suggests that there is some role of sensory experience as a driver, as an important factor here. And we actually can change that, we can in this collaboration tested this explicitly by doing deprivation, by basically preventing structured visual input. You can do this by suturing the eyes and allowing only unstructured visual input to enter. And what you actually observe then is that, for instance, the dimensionality in these deprived animals stays at the level where it was at eye opening, and also the alignment to spontaneous doesn't develop, and also these try-to-try correlation within tri-stability doesn't develop fully. So experience seems to be the driver, and we are currently working on a model how experience could do this, and I just want to give you the basic gist of that. We think of this as a self-stabilizing dynamic selection mechanism, right? So the more frequent the pattern, the stronger its impact on the circuitry. So you have patterns that are more frequent, you have patterns that are less frequent. These are less aligned with spontaneous or also with the other evoked patterns. So you have a stronger impact on the circuitry here, which will lead to a higher probability of these patterns to reoccur at the next day. Yeah? And by this, you have a shrinkage, basically, of the space of patterns that are produced from like high dimensional to low dimensional. Yeah. So increased alignment, higher frequency of occurrence, circuit changes. So this is, we think, this dynamic feedback loop, which basically narrows down the evoked activity and also causes alignment with spontaneous activity. Okay. This is unpublished data. I hope it's going to be submitted soon and on in the archive. Let me, for the last like couple of minutes, focus on a slightly different type of restlessness. And this is now heading towards the mature brain into a different system. This is now mostly focusing on mouse auditory cortex, okay? And here I want to describe, I'm sure it's also present in the ferret visual cortex, because this is a phenomenon that has been actually observed in many different parts of the brain. So my example for restlessness three. So when you look at the lifetime of individual proteins in the brain, then typically the lifetime is only about a week or so. Yeah. And that's actually, here you see a histogram, right, of like 2,000 and something proteins, right? It's actually remarkable, right? Because this means that, these building blocks, and these are, of course, very important building blocks, they are constantly, have to be constantly replaced, right? And there is this question of, if this happens on this molecular scale, what actually happens on the cellular scale and what happens on the network or whole brain scale? Yeah? But to give you an analogy here, this is as if you were driving with your car around and constantly you would have to replace its elements and while it's driving and while it should be fully functional. I mean, this is a challenge to the brain, and one could ask the following, namely, what are the consequences of this ongoing remodeling? Like, on a higher level, are actually the structures stable? I mean, you have how many proteins you have in a cell? Guess? Actually, the number is quite remarkable. It's 50 billion. Huh? So you could say, if I have so many proteins, then maybe I just average out. Yeah. Doesn't matter if there's like a turnover, and there will be it will be stable on the system level, right? So when I take a synapse, where I have actually not 50 billion, of course, but some large number of proteins, this synapse may be stable. Yeah, doesn't change its weight. Here you have a neuron and many synapses labeled, typically 1,000 to 10,000 in a cortical cell, right? But still enough proteins for doing this. So actually, when looking at synapses, however, one of my collaborators from Mainz University, Simon Rumpel, has discovered, and this is consistent with people, other people who have similar discoveries in different systems, has discovered that over the course of several days in mouse auditory cortex, there is actually a change of the synapses. And this is not necessarily a change that is related to learning, that the mouse is learning something, because these are mice that are habituated. So they know the environment, there's no task, they don't do anything, they're bored. Yeah? Moreover, you can even suppress all activity. You can, by genetic methods, suppress all activity, and still you have a change. You have some volatility in the sense that some synapses increase their size, some synapses decrease their size, some synapses will disappear, some new ones get added. And actually, size of synapse, by the way, is a very good predictor of strength, of synaptic strength. So there seems to be this constant remodeling on the synaptic, on the scale of individual synapses, at least. Yeah. And it's, of course, not a proof that this is linked in any ways to this turnover of the proteins. Yeah. It may or may not, but it's interesting to see that there is this turnover on these two levels. And I don't want to stop here. There's actually, I want to move this to more the functional level, because at the end of the day, we would be interested in whether this affects our stability or not. Our stability, we think, is guaranteed, right? I look at you, and if I look at you tomorrow, I will notice, yes, it's the same person and so on. We are used to the assumption that actually our environment and our sensory system is quite stable. But when we look at activity patterns, we actually find that this is not so simple as it seems to be. Yeah. So, and this is collaboration with Simon Rumpel, and these are our students working on that. Mouse, imaged several days, they are habituated, and then the same sounds are played to these mice, and responses are recorded from all these neurons that can be measured here, their activity. And what you see is an activity pattern. So these are 20 identical sounds, yeah? And this is the activity of these, in this case, around 200 neurons. So each row is a neuron. Each column would be a trial where the same sound is played, okay? You can see there is some trial-to-trial variability. There are many neurons actually which don't respond, have low activity. There are a few neurons which respond strongly. Like this neuron really tells the brain this stimulus has been presented here, presumably. And then, not surprisingly, when you go 2 days later, you see the main response in the same neuron and so on. But then suddenly, you see these changes, right? Suddenly, this neuron seems to be much more responsive than that neuron, okay? There is a consistent change in this activity pattern, and we see actually this quite often. I mean, this is just showing you a few examples that there might be populations that don't respond at all to a given sound. Okay, then there are also populations in which several neurons respond quite strongly and reliably, strongly from trial to trial, but also strongly reliably from day to day. Yeah. So this is a stable representation. But then also you have examples where the system didn't respond, didn't care at day one, and 2 days later it cares. And then it stops caring again. This is again an example where it changes. And again, this is actually quite a hot subfield in neuroscience, in theoretical neuroscience. Many people have seen this. It's called representational drift. So the representations change. And there's all kinds of ideas around how the brain could compensate for that, right? So maybe the change is in some subspace that is not relevant for coding. Yeah, maybe basically this change is inside the network, but then the input and the output to the network, they adjust for that. And so, but then also maybe it's not really a bug, maybe it's actually a feature. And this is the last point I want to make here. Maybe it's related to something that you guys know, which is the problem of trying to generalize, right? So in a sense, what you often see are examples. You see something like this, but what you want to learn is something like this. It's more like the concept, right? Like the a representation that is not really, that has basically lost the particularities, the details. Yeah, it's more the general aspects that are learned here. Okay, this is something that is considered to be very important for object recognition, for category learning, and maybe this turnover, that is seen in the brain, has to do with like concepts like dropout. Yeah. So, but maybe in a very informed way, right? Not just random. I mean, from the experimental side, it's hard to say whether it's random or whether it's quasi systematic. But it's interesting to see whether the brain has developed some strategies, and maybe in a way that could also inspire modern or next generation AI. Yeah? So, yeah, this is basically the point here. I come to my conclusions. My conclusions would be threefold. I mean, three levels of restlessness I showed to you. Yeah, there's ongoing spontaneous activity without sensory input, which could encode maybe a prior or some visual memory or visual planning or so on. It's not clear. There is spontaneous activity that definitely shapes what seems to be precursors of sensory representations prior to the onset of experience. And however, these get refined significantly by experience. This is true even for like fundamental representations like visual angle, very basic features, even those are not completely hardwired. And then I was also in the third part talking about the ongoing remodeling in the mature cortex on scales from proteins to activity patterns, and how this could actually play a role in potentially in generalization or in some other aspects of learning or of perception that we have not understood yet. Yeah? So this is still, I mean, it's a question out there, and here I just provide humble speculations. So let me just bring up this slide. So this is part of my lab. People worked on that. These are experimental collaborators. Actually, with Noam Ziff and Simon Rumpel, we have now a German-Israeli grant just being accepted and started called Neurobiology of Forgetting. Not of learning, of forgetting. Yeah? Because forgetting is underestimated. Yeah? If you were learning everything, you would basically be swamped by details, right? You want to forget. I mean, this is about this idea of generalization, right? You want to understand basically the essence of it and remember that, and not the details, or if details, then only of important events, important encounters that you had. Yeah. All right. With this, I should stop, and happy to take questions.